study a portion of your word to take these things and to apply them to our lives so we can be better servants for you and strive to be better servants and to make our way ready for your heavenly home. Lord, we pray that you'll be with those that are unable to be with us this morning, those that we know of that might be sick or suffering, and we pray that you will heal them so they can make it back to us at the next appointed time. Lord, we pray for those that might be traveling, that you would watch over them, keep them safe. Lord, we thank you for this country that we live in, that allows us to worship in this place of comfort and peace. We pray that we will always have that opportunity. We thank you for your son Jesus that's given us that hope of heaven. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Okay, so Hebrews is all about talking about something better, a better law, a better covenant, better than what the Jews had, the old law. But chapter 11 goes a little bit deeper in talking about those that were under that old law, and they had a faith that is different than maybe something that we see today. Some people talk about faith, but it's an empty type of faith. Why is it that these people that we read about in chapter 11 were able to have a full assurance of faith? What is it that God did that gave these people the full assurance of faith? They did what they were commanded, but what was it on God's side? What did God do? He fulfilled everything he said he was going to do. He fulfilled all of his promises. So they were able to have this full assurance of faith. They were able to do this obedient faith, seeing these things afar off, and knew that he was going to fulfill these promises because he had already fulfilled promises for them. And that's the type of faith that we read about in this first verse of Hebrews chapter 11. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. They had already seen him fulfill promises, but they were seeing things far off that they weren't going to be able to see fulfilled because they were going to die before these things were fulfilled. And they knew and believed that and had this full hope that they were going to be fulfilled of a heavenly home that we're about to read about here later on in this chapter, and knew that that was going to be fulfilled because he had already fulfilled promises for them. And this is a type of hope that people outside of God and outside of Christ don't have and can't have, because that's a different type of hope. It's an empty hope that they can't have. And so all of the spiritual blessings are in Christ. And that's something that we can read about here in the scriptures. So let's begin in verse 11, and we're going to read through verse 16 here to begin with. So, through faith also, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the sea shore innumerable. There all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly, Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. So we've seen throughout so far that the writer here in chapter 11 is pointing out specific people that have been faithful in some way, and each one has not just been, it's not just said, has been faithful, but in what way have they been faithful? They've done something, right? They've been obedient to show that faith. In the religious world today, we've seen people that have an empty faith. They don't do anything to show their faith. But in James, we see that we have to do something to show our faith. A lot of times when we talk about that, we get criticized for that because it's called work salvation, as people say. But it's commanded. In order to have true faith, we have to demonstrate our faith.
And without works is dead.
It's dead. Right. And it's one preacher said that if you have faith in one hand, it's like being in a boat with one oar, and you just go in circles. But you have to have works in the other hand, and that's the only way to make it down the river, is to have both oars, faith and works, and that's the way you make it. If you only have one, you're making it in circles, and going in circles doesn't help us. So we have to have both. And that's what we see here in chapter 11, is both being demonstrated, faith and works. Every single time, by faith, somebody does something. And here, we're seeing in verse 11 that Sarah had faith. Let's go to Genesis chapter 18, and let's see this account of Sarah. Because at first, she denied. She didn't believe at first. Yeah. What was the problem with this promise that God had made with Sarah? With Sarah specifically, what was the problem with her that would make her doubt? She was of old age, but she was barren, right? And somebody, a woman that is barren, in their mind, it's impossible, and usually in physical terms, it is impossible to have a child. And so let's read here verses 12 through 15. Steve, could you read that for us, please? Genesis 18, 12 through 15.
Therefore, Sarah laughed in herself, saying, after I have grown old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord, being old also? The Lord said to Abraham, why does Sarah laugh, saying, I surely bear a child since I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah will have a son. But Sarah denied it, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. And he said, no, that you did,
man. All right, thank you. This is where, in some translations, some versions, the lettering, capital letters, lowercase letters, gets a little bit tricky. Not sure how the New King James does it, but in the King James, for sure, we have in verse 12, when she says, my Lord being old also, we have all lowercase. How does the New King James put that?
Abraham.
Right, it's talking about Abraham. So she's talking about her husband, my Lord being old also. So notice it says she laughed within herself.
Yeah, and he's still
there. Yeah. Do we try to hide things from God? Sometimes we do. We think that we're doing things behind closed doors. We think that we do things in our mind, and we're hiding from God. And that's what Sarah's trying to do here. She's trying to hide this from God. And verse 13, and the Lord, all capitalized. Who is this? This is Jehovah God. This is the Wherefore did Sarah laugh? So God is telling Aunt Sarah to Abraham. Sarah just laughed. Wherefore did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I of a surety bear a child which am old?
He's telling her a very thought.
Yeah, knew it. Knew it to a T. God knows our thoughts. In fact, there is a verse. Jesus even mentions how God knows our thoughts, because he talks about how even if a man, and this goes to women as well, but even if a man thinks or minds lustfully about a woman, then that's a sin. So God knows our very thoughts. Verse 14, is anything too hard for the Lord? No. And this is a rhetorical question. He's asking this on purpose. He's not asking this to be answered, obviously, because he knows the answer. At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah will have a son. It's going to happen, because I said it's going to happen. I'm promising that it's going to happen, and she did. Now, was this Ishmael? No, because Ishmael was already born to Hagar. And that was Abraham trying to force God's hand a little bit. Sarah kind of had some hand in that as well. Because she said, here, have my hand made.
She was born to God.
Yeah. Then we get to verse 15. Sarah, why did Sarah lie about laughing? What was the reason for her lying? She was afraid. Because she knew that God knew her thoughts. She found out that God knew her thoughts. Yeah. Yeah. We should know better that God knows everything. And I think probably deep back in her mind, she probably knew that God knew. But she just doubted. She didn't have faith right then. But because of her fear, now she knows, and she's going to have faith that this is going to happen. So it took her fear to have faith. And sometimes that's what it takes, is a little bit of fear of God in order for us to have faith. But through her faith is how everything came about, that we would have Isaac, and through Isaac is the lineage of Christ. And that's how we ended up with our Savior. And not only that, but we get to verse 12 in Hebrews chapter 11. Therefore, even of one, which is Christ, and him as good as dead, as many as the stars of the sky in multitude. What was the promise that God gave to Abraham? Right. And his seed would be innumerable. You wouldn't be able to count it. This promise is extended that it's not just he's going to be a great nation, but because we get through Christ, now the seed is Christians, and the seed is innumerable. It becomes innumerable because it's not just physical seed. It becomes spiritual seed as well. Because, like we read in Ephesians chapter 6, the Israel of God is the church. And so now Abraham's seed becomes innumerable because it's not just physical, it's spiritual. Even of one, which is Christ, and then the promise of the not being able to count just like the stars. So that promise was made through Sarah, through Abraham. These all died in strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Are we still strangers and pilgrims on the earth if we are God's?
Yes.
And I should do that as long as we see on Israel just passing through. It's not our home.
Yep. This world is not my home. And if we belong to God, where is our home? Heaven. And we need to always remember that we are prepared for that home. Prepared place for prepared people. That's right. Verse 14, for they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. What's the country? Again, heaven. Right. So if we're pilgrims here, this is not our country. This is not our home. This is not our land. We are seeking for that heavenly country.
James says,
oh.
Which is basically what it is.
Yeah. I like that wording too. Yeah. 15. And truly, if they had been mindful of that, and King James has country in italics, so it's added. From whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. Why would he not be ashamed? It goes back to the whole theme of this chapter. Their faith through obedience, right? And they kept that faith all the way through because they knew that God was going to deliver his promises all the way to the end. What is the only promise that hasn't been fulfilled?
Jesus coming.
Right. Yeah, his return and judgment. And so there is still one that we see afar off that we need to have faith and continue just like these. And so if we want God to not be ashamed to be called our God, then we need to continue like these people. And so these are, in a sense, our example that we need to remain faithful. Any questions or comments there? All right, let's get verses 18 through 29. This would be the next section here. All right. Of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, by faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, according that God was able to raise him up, even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. By faith Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. By faith Jacob, when he was dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph and worshipped, leaning upon the top of his staff. By faith, Joseph, when he died, made mention of the departing of the children of Israel, and gave commandment concerning his bones. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming to reproach the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he had respect upon the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, which the Egyptians assay to do or drown. So here in 17, we switch from Sarah to Abraham, and we have already seen a little bit about Abraham. Abraham was back in verse 8. That one was when he was told to go to a different country. Now we're getting to Abraham and the sacrifice of Isaac. So Abraham, when he was told to offer up Isaac, and he that received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. So why was Abraham not afraid to offer up Isaac?
Well, he knew that God promised that it would be through Isaac, so he could be killed and he would not be afraid again. Isaac was going to live.
Some way or another, yes. Abraham had faith that God was going to take care of it all. Because, as we see in 18, Isaac was the promised seed. Not Ishmael, but Isaac.
That's big faith. He believed it because God said so.
Mm-hmm. We have the saying that was really popular here several years ago. God said it, I believe it. There's three parts to it. God said it, I believe it, that settles it. And the way that I like it is God said it, that settles it. Because really it doesn't matter if we believe it or not, God said it. We should believe it, but it doesn't matter if we believe it or not. And with Abraham, God said it, and that settled it. He was going to do whatever God said. It didn't matter. And here, it was, like you said, it was big-time faith, because this is a shadow of Christ, of his death, his sacrifice. Abraham is like God here, and Isaac is like Christ.
He wasn't asking Abraham to do anything that he wasn't fixing to do.
Right. Or wasn't willing to do.
Yes.
God was willing to put his only begotten son on the cross, or allow him to die. And we see now that Abraham was willing to do. That was God's words, is, I see that you're, I've lost the words there. I don't have a reference here, let's see. He said, now I know that you're not, that you are willing. He went all the way to the point of raising the knife. And that's when God stopped him. And so we know that Abraham was going to drop the knife and go all the way. And God went all the way and allowed Jesus to die. And Jesus had to die because he was the perfect sacrifice. He was the only way that we could have salvation. And if the death of Christ had been stopped, then we wouldn't have that salvation, or that opportunity at salvation. And with both of these, the sacrifice had to be willing. Isaac had to be willing, and Christ had to be willing. When we look at all of the animal sacrifices, those are completely different. Animals can't think. Animals are not willing sacrifices. That's why here in Hebrews we read that the blood of bulls and goats can't sit. There had to be a willing sacrifice. And that's why Christ was the only one. faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph and worshiped, leaning upon the top of his staff. And Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departing of the children of Israel, making or giving commandment concerning his bones. He had no idea what was going to happen in the future, except for the fact that God had given him visions of things to come, and so he had faith that they were going to be able to make it out.
Even went so far as he wanted his bones in that promised land.
Right.
That God is delivering.
And we can read about that in Joshua 24 and verse 32. So he had faith that they were going to be able to make it out of Israel. And he didn't want his bones left behind in that place. I want my bones in the promised land. Carry me out. And so he gave that command. And that took place hundreds of years later. That's how far away it was, and that's how much faith that Joseph had that this was going to happen. This is a lot like the promise that God was going to destroy. I can't remember which one it was, but that one took place 400 years later. And God keeps his promises. It doesn't matter how long it's going to be, he keeps his promises. And these people have this faith, and they see it afar off. By faith, Moses, when he was born, he was hid for 3 months of his parents, verse 23 here, because they saw he was a proper child. Let's see, I'm going to go back. Let's see what the Greek here is for proper. Sometimes that means cutting out things that Moses did, the things of Egypt were things he needed to cut out of his life, because that would have been the pleasures of sin for a season, because it was not of God. But he needed to go back to the Hebrews, the Israelites, because they were God's people. And they were suffering affliction because they were in bondage. And this is one of those types, any type, shadows of what it's like to get out of the world and become a Christian. When we're becoming a Christian, we're leaving the Egyptian life and instead going into the bondage of Christianity. And sometimes we need to leave some of those things behind and completely turn our back. And that's hard for some people to do. But that's what Moses was willing to do. He turned his back on a life of pleasure, a life of riches, a life of ease. Instead, he wanted to suffer affliction. If we are truly living the life of a Christian, in some ways we're going to suffer. We're going to be persecuted. We're going to give up pleasures. And that's the way it has to be if we want to be a child of Christ, a child of God. Verse 26, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. And again, he was looking forward. Because when Christ died on the cross, which direction or directions did the blood flow? It flowed backwards to cover all of those that were faithful under the old law. But it also flows forward unto all those that obey. Hebrews 9 and verse 5. Survey, even still today, because they've done this before, but if you were to do a survey in all of the United States and ask people, do you believe in God? They'll say yes. Do you believe in Jesus? Many of them will say yes. But then you ask them about the things of obedience. Do you believe in baptism? They'll say no. Because they don't believe that it's necessary. I was talking to one of my students because it's an AP class, we're done, and all my seniors were done for class wise Wednesday, and so I didn't have anybody except two juniors in class. And we were talking about how to obey the gospel and things like that, and he had said he didn't believe in baptism. And he said, when I think about baptism, I go back to the thief on the cross. And I said, okay, so I let him talk for a minute. And I said, well, what law told him, I said, we have to know how to rightly divide the Word of God. And just because something is in the New Testament doesn't mean that that's what it is.
Well, when you talk about what Moses did and Abraham, the examples.
And he didn't understand that. But a lot of people will say that they believe in God. They say they believe in Jesus. But when it comes to the things of obedience that was commanded by God and Jesus, they don't believe. And so they don't believe Hebrews chapter 11, and they don't follow this example.
Because they were told, like I was told as a child, no matter what you do since Jesus died, you're okay. That's why I was raised to believe.
Yep. No, I was taught that too. As long as you believe, you're good. And some would go a little bit further. As long as you believe, and as long as you go to worship service, you're fine. And because my mom would say that I would need to go to worship service. I need to be.
I was told I didn't need to.
Yeah.
He died. That's it.
My dad always told me he believed as long as you were born into a quote unquote Christian family. What he believed that was completely off the wall. Then you were okay and you didn't have to go anywhere. And for the longest time, he made my mom believe she didn't have to go anywhere.
Well, you believe one, not another.
Right. Yeah. It was like Paul said with the old law, if you hold to one, you hold to all of them. And that's true for the New Testament as well. We hold to one, we have to hold to them all. Otherwise, we're not in obedience. So, and I guarantee you, if we did a survey, that's what we would find. So, continuing with Moses here, verse 27, by faith, he forsook Egypt. He turned his back on them, and not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Who is this invisible? Yeah, it's God. We can't see God, but we can see what about God? We can see the evidence of God, which goes back to verse 1. We can't see the wind, but we can see the evidence of the wind. One that I brought up when we started this chapter is we can't see what causes sickness, but we can see the evidence of it. We can't see the viruses, we can't see the bacteria, and we can see it with a microscope, but we can't see it physically with our own eyes.
You know, that's a lot of people, scientists say that, they prove to me, I want to see it. Well, there's a lot of things they can't see, so that's contradictory.
A lot of the things that scientists claim to believe in, they can't see it. And it takes more faith for what they believe in than it does for what we believe in. And they won't back down. Like the Big Bang Theory is explosion and confusion, disorder, but yet you look at our universe, you look at our galaxies, and there's order. Every single galaxy that you look at, and I was talking to the same student, every single galaxy that you look at, the planets are orbiting in a pattern, and it's not random. When you look at our universe, from our perspective, everything is expanding out from where we are. If we were from somewhere else, it would probably be expanding from their perspective. And so that's why scientists don't come. here. Through faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith, they passed through the Red Sea, as by dry land, which the Egyptians assayed to do, were drowned. So, in other words, the Egyptians passed through, or sorry, the Israelites passed through on dry land. The Egyptians tried to do the same thing, and they were wiped out and drowned. There are many places that we have tried to find where this was, the crossing itself. I think there was one archaeologist who thinks he found a certain place and thinks he found chariot wheels. I think I was watching a documentary on that. But I don't know that we've actually confirmed that we found the crossing. It doesn't really matter.
And then I've seen somewhere that across the Red Sea, it was wet.
Yeah.
But right here, right.
Yeah, they crossed over on dry land. God was, if they crossed over on muddy ground, you have to think they would have sunk in this mud, because where there would have been this amount of water and it had just come away, that mud would have been wet extremely deep, like probably up into here, and they would have sunk and wouldn't have been able to cross. It just wouldn't have been able to happen.
And they were dealing with a lot of things.
Like, yeah, they would have been heavy. It would have been
how scary that would be.
Yeah.
You would have to have real good faith to just go across, because if it's due to you and it did the Egyptians, mm-hmm. that would take a lot of faith, because that'd be scary.
Yeah. If it was muddy and those Israelites looked across there and saw that, you got to be thinking, God, are you sure about this? No, it was dry ground, and that would have been the only way that they could have made it. And then the Egyptians, it would have still been dry ground when they started out across there, because that would have been the only way they would have had confidence to follow. And their entire army would have had to have made it out across. So that means that the Israelites had plenty of a head start to be able to make it completely across, enough for the entire Egyptian army to make it all the way out there and then get wiped out. So some of this you have to read into it, but it has to be logical in order for it to make sense.
People don't even understand it. This didn't just happen. 30
minutes
time period, about an hour.
Yeah.
There was over 1 million people that crossed.
Yeah. It took a long time for this to happen. And Pharaoh didn't just immediately, as soon as they left, think, oh, I'm going to go after him right now. No, he took some time, and then he changed his mind and thought, oh, I'm going to go after him. I better go get these people. And that's why they had plenty of time. They had enough of a head start for this to happen. Okay, we'll go ahead and stop right there. Any more questions or comments? Okay. We'll pick up on verse 30 with the walls of Jericho next week, and we'll see how Earl's doing, but he could probably finish this out. Start with verse 30.